we are discussing unitary operators. More generally, we will discuss what are called as normal operators. But before that, there is one last result. I told you briefly about this last time. I will prove this result. What is the relationship between the matrices of a linear transformation corresponding to two orthonormal bases? Okay. So this is the framework. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space. Let us take two orthonormal bases. Let us say B1, I will use W1, W2, etcetera, Wn. This is an orthonormal basis. I have another one, I will use V1, V2. Suppose these are ordered orthonormal bases. For V, okay. Now, for any two bases, we have derived one or two relationships. For instance, if you look at a fixed arbitrary vector X, then if you look at the matrix of X relative to B2, this is related to the matrix of X relative to B1 by means of the following formula. Okay. The matrix of X relative to B2 is equal to identity matrix between the bases B1, B2. That is, I write down the elements of the basis vector B1. That is W1, W2, etc. W1. Let us say W1. That is a linear combination of these vectors. That will be the first column of this matrix, etc. Write down W1 in terms of V1, etc. Vn. That will be the last column of this. In general, if B1 is not equal to B2, then the matrix of the identity transformation is not the identity matrix, okay. It is never the identity matrix unless B1 is equal to B2. But in any case, this matrix is invertible, okay. Note that this matrix, that is a matrix of the identity operator. Matrix of the identity operator with respect to these two bases, this is invertible, okay. I will call it P inverse. Set P inverse to be the matrix of the identity transformation. I know that P is invertible. I know that this is invertible, so I am just calling it P inverse. Let us now define. Yes. What is the reason? You should tell me. Okay. Suppose you take this matrix, let us call it Q, okay. Suppose Q into X is equal to 0, Q into X is equal to, X is a vector in V, okay. I am talking about a matrix. So let us take X to be in Rn or in RCn, okay. For simplicity, let us take Rn, call this matrix Q, okay. X belongs to Rn, Qx equal to 0. Does it mean X is 0? Yes. Over, this is square matrix, homogeneous system Qx equal to 0 has a unique solution 0, so it must be invertible, okay. See, all this we have seen before. I am just trying to quickly recall these things so that we will be able to go to an inner product space. What we know all these things for an ordinary finite dimensional vector space. We are trying to specialize these results for the inner product space, okay. I will define now a linear map U let u belong to L of V be defined by defining a linear transformation U using these two bases. The definition is U of Wi equals Vi. Define a linear map. Between two bases, one can define a linear map, then it is completely determined. So this is the map U. Now remember that the bases B1, B2 are orthonormal, so this U is unitary from the results that we have seen before. U is of course linear, this U is unitary. U is unitary, it takes a particular basis, particular orthonormal basis to another orthonormal basis, so this must be unitary. So I am defining a linear operator from B1 to B2 like this. UWi is Vi, and I am trying to look at the matrix of U relative to just B1. That is, this is by definition the matrix of U relative to B1, just this basis. Just this basis, okay. Same basis, not different. Then this will be B1, etcetera, B1, which is by definition V1 relative to B1, V2 relative to B2, etcetera, Vn relative to B1. There is only one basis, okay. Okay, what is VB1 from this equation? V1, B1, V2, B1, etcetera. I can write this as V1, B1 from this equation. V1, B1 from this equation is this inverse into VB2. Okay, but this inverse is P. So tell me if this is correct. The first vector is P. P is a matrix, remember, into the matrix of V1 relative to B2. So I am using this equation. From this equation, VB1 is what I want to write. V1, B1, V2, B1, etc. VB1 is what I want to write. VB1 is the inverse of this matrix into VB2. But the inverse of this matrix is P, because P inverse is this. So VB1 is P times VB2. That is what I have written, etc. The matrix P times VnB1. Sorry, this is B2. Now it is B2. From B1 I have moved to B2 by making use of this equation and the notation that the inverse of this matrix is P. Now you see what is going on. V1, V2, etcetera, they are the second basis elements. So the representation in terms of B2 is just E1, E2, etcetera. So this is PE1, PE2, etcetera, PEN. But you know that for matrices, if this is what I have for a single matrix P, then this can be written, I can take the P outside. So this is P into E1, E2, etcetera, EN, but that is identity. So this is just P. This is just a matrix P. So if you look at the matrix of U relative to B1, 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 then it is P. Does it follow that P is a unitary matrix? Yes, because U is a unitary matrix. The matrix of a unitary matrix of a unitary operator relative to any two orthonormal bases, that is a unitary matrix. So this P is a unitary matrix. P is unitary. P is a unitary matrix. U is a unitary operator. And finally, recall how the matrix of a linear transformation corresponding to two bases look like. Take a general matrix, general operator. Let T element of LV. Then the matrix of T relative to B2 can be written as a matrix P inverse into the matrix of T relative to B1 P. Okay, I remember we used the notation MT M inverse, but MT M inverse, but M inverse is equal to this matrix. Okay, so you can go back to that notation and verify that this is what we have got. Instead of M, we have P inverse. It must be MT M inverse. Instead of M, we have P inverse. Okay, but P is unitary, so this is P star T B1 P. So this is the relationship then. The matrix of a linear operator corresponding to one basis, one orthonormal basis, it is related to the matrix of the same linear operator with respect to another orthonormal basis in this manner. So this matrix P is unitary. This is for the complex case. For the real case, for the real inner product case, the matrix of T relative to B2 is P transpose the matrix of T relative to B1 into P, real orthogonal matrix. So in this case, P will be an orthogonal matrix. Okay, so this is a relationship. There is a definition coming out of this relationship. This is called unitary equivalence. This is called orthogonal equivalence. That is, two matrices B and A are said to be unitarily equivalent if there exists a unitary matrix P such that B can be written as P star AP. Similarly, two real matrices B and A are said to be orthogonally equivalent if there exists an orthogonal matrix P such that B equal to P transpose AP. Okay, this is more specialized than the usual equivalence of diagonalization which comes from the similarity transformation. Matrices A and B are said to be similar if B can be written as P inverse AP for some invertible matrix P. In that case, this is what leads to the definition of diagonalization. If A is a matrix such that A can be written as P inverse DP, where D is a diagonal matrix, then A is said to be diagonalizable. Okay. Similarly here, if a matrix A is said to be diagonalizable by means of an orthogonal transformation or by means of a unitary transformation, if there exists either an orthogonal matrix P or a unitary matrix P such that A can be written as either P transpose DP or P star DP, second case when A is complex. Okay, we will be interested in this question. Diagonalization was discussed when we discussed operators on finite dimensional vector spaces. We will discuss unitary equivalence. Okay, given a complex matrix, when does it happen that there exists a diagonal matrix D such that A can be written as P star DP, where P is unitary? Okay, we will address this question. This is for unitary equivalence. Let us look at now more general operators called normal operators. Okay, but a little more particular is a self-adjoint operator. I will discuss self-adjoint operators and then move to normal operators. So for these are the operators which will give you the correct answer for this question. Given a complex matrix A, when is it unitarily equivalent to a diagonal matrix? Okay, but before that, let's look at this problem. See, this is really the final problem in finite dimensional inner product spaces. The problem is, given a linear transformation T, given T element of LV, where the framework is V is a finite dimensional inner product space. given a linear operator T on a finite dimensional linear product space V, when does it happen that there exists an orthonormal basis B, such that orthonormal basis B for V, such that each vector in B is an eigenvector for T. This question we asked for the usual vector space, not the inner product space. We will try to answer this for the inner product space, where you will see that the notions of self-adjoint normal operators come naturally. Now, before answering this question, let us see what happens if T satisfies such a property. Suppose there is an orthonormal basis B such that each vector of that basis is an eigenvector for T, okay. Then what happens? So we are really looking at the necessary condition. If this happens, what? This question is really sufficient. When does it happen that this holds? Suppose this happens. Suppose that there exists a basis. Let me call the elements v1, v2, vn. Suppose there exists an orthonormal basis. Orthonormal basis B such that each vector in the basis is an eigenvector. So that means T V I equals lambda I V I. This holds. What is the meaning of this? The meaning of this is related to the problem of diagonalization. So if you look at the matrix of T relative to the basis B for which this happens, T must be a diagonal matrix. Just look at the right hand side. T V1 is lambda 1 V1. So the first column is lambda 1, all other entries 0, etc. So T B is lambda 1 0 0 0, 0 lambda 2, etc. All entries 0, the last entry is lambda. That is, you get the diagonal matrix whose diagonal entries are the eigenvalues. Here some of these eigenvalues may repeat. I am just assuming that they are lambda 1, etc. lambda 1. Some of these may repeat, that is possible. So the matrix of T relative to the basis for which this happens, that matrix is a diagonal matrix. What about the matrix of T star relative to B? This question we can ask because we are in inner products. The matrix of T star relative to B is lambda 1 bar. See, in general it is a complex vector space, all other entries 0, okay. This is from one of the results that we have discussed. If A is a matrix of T relative to an orthonormal basis B, B is a matrix of T relative to another normal, sorry, the same orthonormal basis, matrix of T star, then A is equal to B star. So T star has this representation. If V is real, then T is equal to T star. That is, T is self-adjoint. If V is real, then T is equal to T star. I can even write T transpose, okay. If V is complex, then T is equal to T star is not true, but T star equal to T star T. Okay. Two diagonal matrices any two diagonal matrices come out. T star T equal to T T star. An operator T that satisfies such an equation is called a normal operator. Called a normal operator. So if I have a complex finite dimensional vector space V which has an orthonormal basis satisfying this property, that is each of the vector coming from the basis is an eigenvector for the operator T, then T must be a normal operator, okay. T must be a normal operator. Now what is interesting is that see this is only an SRE condition I told you, but interestingly this condition is also sufficient. That is what we will show is that if I have a complex finite dimensional inner product space V and if T is a normal operator, then T is diagonalizable by means of a unitary matrix, okay. By the way, can you see the unitary matrix? See, I have not written down the unitary matrix here explicitly. Can you see what that unitary matrix must be? I will just write on the diagonal form. Can you see that unitary matrices are hidden in this? Okay, just think about it. Whenever we say that a matrix of a linear transformation relative to a basis is a diagonal matrix, it means there is a matrix P such that A equals P inverse DP. That is what I have written down here. There is also, see if you look at the mat, see this matrix A, this is the diagonal matrix D, then A will be equal to P star DP, that is hidden in this equation, okay. So this is unitary equivalence, this is unitary equivalence of this matrix with this diagonal matrix, okay. What we will see is that the converse is also true, that is if T is a normal operator, then there is a diagonal matrix D such that this equation holds for some orthonormal basis B, okay. That is why I wanted to first write down this implication, the necessity part. This is also a sufficient condition, and for the real case we will show that if T is equal to T star, then T is T is orthogonally equivalent to the matrix of T relative to a basis, an orthonormal basis, is orthogonally equivalent to a diagonal matrix, okay. But before that, let us look at some properties. Properties of self-adjoint operators. Okay, so just to summarize, we have seen that for the real space, real inner product space case, if an operator is self-adjoint, then there exists an orthonormal, for the real case, what we have seen is, if there is a basis B which has a property that each vector from the basis is an eigenvector for the operator T, then T is self-adjoint. In the complex case, we have shown that if this happens, then T must be normal. We will prove the converse also, okay. But as I told you, some properties before we prove these results. Let us look at the self-adjoint case. For the self-adjoint case, we have the following. So this is in general, this is a dimension-free result. So let T be a self-adjoint operator, on a finite dimensional inner product space. Then we have the following. All the eigenvalues of T are real numbers. all the eigenvectors of eigenvalues of T are real numbers. Eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues. Or can you make a guess here? We have seen the general case. We have studied the general case earlier. T is a linear operator on a finite dimensional vector space V. Then eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are, do you remember the property that we proved? For any operator, eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues, they are linearly independent for a general vector space. If you have an inner product space, they are orthogonal, something more. Okay. If you have a self-adjoint operator and an inner product space, then you can say something more. Eigenvalues are real in the first place. Eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are orthogonal. Proof. First, I want to show that the eigenvalues are real. So let's take Tx equals lambda x. That is, x is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. Remember, an eigenvector by definition is a non-zero vector. Okay. I want to show that lambda is real. So I will look at the inner product lambda x comma x. This is lambda x comma x. I have taken lambda into the first argument. I will use this lambda x equal to tx. So there is inner product tx comma x. Tx comma x can be written as x comma t star x. That's the definition of the adjoint, but t star is t. So this is x comma tx. Again, use tx equals lambda x. This is inner product x comma lambda x. Lambda comes in the second argument, so it goes out with a complex conjugate. So this is lambda bar x comma x. So lambda x comma x is equal to lambda bar x comma x. X is a non-zero eigenvector, so the dot product of x with itself cannot be zero. In fact, that's a positive number, so lambda must be equal to lambda bar. Okay. So lambda is real. All eigenvalues of a self-adjoint operator must be real numbers. Lambda non-zero.
You're asking this question.
Definition of eigenvector. See, look at Tx equals lambda x, that can be written as T minus, okay, look at the matrix case. A minus lambda I of x is equal to 0. This has a non-trivial solution if and only if the determinant of A minus lambda I is not 0. Okay. But we want non-trivial solutions. That happens only if determinant of A minus lambda I is 0. So lambda could be 0, that's not a problem. Why? What's the problem? If A is a singular matrix, lambda could be 0. It is a condition on x, x must be non-zero. Lambda can be 0, there is no problem. Okay. We are seeking non-trivial solutions of a homogeneous equation. That happens if and only if the determinant of that coefficient matrix is 0. That gives rise to this definition. That is, A minus lambda I is singular for a matrix. For an operator, T minus lambda I is singular. For an operator, T minus lambda I is singular. You can show that this happens if and only if the matrix of T minus lambda with respect to any basis is singular. That is why this question of Tx equals lambda x just gets passed on to the equation Ax equals lambda x, where A is a matrix of T. Okay, so this proves lambda is real. Eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are orthogonal. So let us take Tx equals lambda x, Ty equals mu y, where of course x is not 0, y is not 0, lambda is not mu. I have eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues. I must show that they are orthogonal. So consider again lambda x comma y. As before, this is lambda x comma y, that is lambda x is Tx, Tx comma y. This can be written as x comma t star y. T is self-adjoint, x comma ty. X comma ty is x comma mu y. Entirely similar to the previous proof. Mu bar comes out, mu bar xy, but mu is real because of what we proved in the first part. So this is mu xy. Lambda xy equals mu xy. Lambda not equal to mu. These are numbers. Lambda not equal to mu. So this means in the product xy is 0. This is something more than saying that they are independent. This of course does not say anything about the existence of eigenvalues. It says if the eigenvalues exist, then they must be real for a self-adjoint operator, and they must be orthogonal if they correspond to distinct eigenvalues. Let us prove that for a self-adjoint operator, first eigenvalues exist. Then T has eigenvalues. The proof will use fundamental theorem of algebra. Any polynomial of degree n must have at least one root real or complex. Real or complex. Okay. So. Let us take, let B be a basis, an orthonormal basis, ordered orthonormal basis. For V, and let us call A as the matrix of T relative to B. Then A is self-adjoint. A is a Hermitian matrix. A is equal to A star. Okay. Orthonormal basis. So A is equal to A star. Consider consider the equation A minus lambda I of x equal to 0. I want to show that this equation has a non-trivial solution. Okay. Since determinant of A minus lambda I equal to 0. So consider this equation, determinant A minus lambda I equal to 0. See, in general this happens in a complex vector space, okay. I have already made this assertion that determinant of A minus lambda is equal to 0. So I will use this explanation to show that this equation has a non-trivial solution. But then can you justify this statement? Why is determinant of A minus lambda I 0? I will just specify for some lambda element of F. F is R or C depending on whether it is a complex or a, whether it is a real or a complex space for some lambda element. Can you justify this? Fundamental theorem of algebra again. See, this equation is a polynomial equation of degree n, okay. It will have at least one root, real or complex. But can you see that? Okay, suppose there is a lambda equals lambda naught for which determinant A minus lambda naught I is 0. Consider the general complex case, lambda naught is a complex number. If I am in the complex space setting, then this equation will have a solution for that lambda naught, non-trivial solution X for that lambda naught, okay. But forget about it. What we want is, more importantly, there exists a lambda naught such that A minus lambda naught I x is equal to 0 for x not equal to 0. So we have a complex number in that case, okay. But in general it is a complex number. In the real case also that will be a complex number, okay. See, if it is a complex space there is no problem, the proof is there, proof is over. If it is a real space, then this number lambda naught could be complex. But if the number lambda naught is complex, then can you see that that needs a little explanation, but you can write it down. If the number lambda naught is complex, the vector x will also be complex, okay. First can you see that lambda naught cannot be complex? Okay, I think that needs an explanation. Okay, so what I want to say is then the following. In the complex case, that is the underlying field is complex. This means in the complex case, since there exists lambda naught element of C such that determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to 0, by fundamental theorem of algebra, we conclude that A has an eigenvalue. By the way, this has to be real because we have just now shown that if you have a self-adjoint operator, then eigenvalues must be real, okay. So just to specify, I will write lambda naught belongs to R also, okay. This is a complex case. In the real case, again lambda naught is real, okay. In the real case also there exists lambda naught in R such that Ax equals lambda naught x not equal to 0. Then what is the problem? The only problem is that x could be complex, but remember A is real, lambda is real. If x is complex, then for each coordinate of x I take the real part, imaginary part. Real part forms a vector, imaginary part forms another vector. So I will have something like A into z plus iy equals lambda naught into z plus iy, where z and y will have real entries. Equate real imaginary parts, you will get real eigenvalues, real eigenvectors, okay. The only thing in this case is Remember, the fact that lambda naught is real comes from the previous result, okay. But before that, I have the equation Ax equals lambda naught x. This x could be complex. This x could be complex. But then take the real and imaginary parts of x and make use of the fact that the entries of A are real and the fact that lambda naught is real. You can take out the real parts of x, take out the real part of x, imaginary part of x. In fact, each one will be an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda, okay. So I will just conclude by saying, by taking the real part, for instance, we conclude that A has an eigenvalue. Just take the real part of x, that will be an eigenvector. Either the real part or the imaginary part will be non-zero. Both cannot be 0. Either the real part or the imaginary part will be non-zero. So one of them will be, at least one of them will be an eigenvector. And so that number lambda, lambda naught, is an eigenvalue. Okay, that is the explanation for the real case. Okay, think of the other properties I will prove in the next class.